Dear students, today we shall continue the topic file system implementation. Today we shall begin with direct implementation. We already learned what is a direct file. Direct file is basically containing other files. It is basically acting as a container for the different related files. It means a group of files are put into a directory. So that is also called as a folder. Now let us see how to implement a directory. The operating system. So there are different ways to implement directory in the operating system. Now let us begin with linear list. So linear list is basically linked list implementation of the directory. So in the linear list, we basically maintain different nodes containing a file name and pointer to the data blocks. A node in the linked list containing name of the file and pointer to the data blocks. So this linear list basically containing the list of file names. So this is basically very simple to program, but it is time consuming to execute. Suppose that you want to create a new file, we must search the directory to make sure that the file is not exist. If the file already exists, then we cannot create a new file. If the file does not exist, then only we need to create a new file. So that is why whenever you want to create a new file, we need to search the entire directory. And if the file is not exist, then only we need to create the file. It means at the time of creating a new file, we are supposed to search the directory. And if the file does not exist, then a new entry will be created. It is added at the end of the directory. It means a new node will create the linked list, which is added at the end of the linked list. Similarly, to delete a file, again we need to search the directory for the specified file name. If the file exists, then the memory space which is allocated to the particular file needs to be freed, or a node which is created for the particular file must be deleted. So there is some difficulty with the linear list implementation. It is adding a linear search time. That is the time required to search a file in the linear list is basically linear. Suppose that you want to search for nth node in the linear list, the time required will be n here. So this has a linear search time, that is adding overhead. And here you can keep the files ordered alphabetically, either use a linked list or use the B plus trees. Now let us move on to the next method of implementing directory, that is the hash table. So in order to reduce the searching time of the linear list, we can make use of hash table. So in the hash table, of course, also we make use of linear list to store the directory entries, but hash structure is also used here. So we know that in the hash table we make use of some hash function. The hash function is basically taking the file name as input and it is computing some value. So depending upon that, what we do is we keep the entries in the linear list. It means the hash table takes a value computed from file name and returns a pointer to the file name in the linear list. So with the help of hash table, the searching time will be decreased as compared to linear list, but it may lead to collisions. What is collision? So there may be a situation where two file names hash to the same location. If you take the two file names having the same name, and after applying the hash function, we get the same location. Hash tables are good only if entries are fixed size, and it depends on the hash function on that particular size. Or else we can make use of another technique, that is a chain overflow method. Okay, in this method, in order to resolve hash collision, what we can do is we can add a new entry to the linked list. Now let us move on to the next topic, that is allocation methods. An allocation method basically refers to how these blocks are allocated for files. Already learned that a disk will be consisting of number of data blocks, and how data blocks are allocated to the different files. So that is called as allocation method. So there are different allocation methods. So let us begin with one of the important and most widely used allocation method, that is the contiguous allocation. So in the contiguous allocation, each file occupies a set of contiguous blocks. It is a continuous data blocks will be allocated to the files. So let us see what are the benefits of contiguous allocation. It is best performance in most of the cases. It is very simple to implement. Only thing is that we'll have to mention the starting location of starting blocks in the starting block in the disk, and the length of the blocks are required, that is the number of blocks that we need to allocate to the file. For example, if a file is having n blocks, that is the length of the file is n block, and we starts at location 17, then it occupies the blocks, continuous blocks or contiguous blocks starting from block B, the next block is B plus 1, B plus 2, and so on. So like this, contiguous blocks will be allocated to the files. There are some problem with contiguous allocation, like finding space for file. It might be difficult to find the contiguous space for a file. Okay, and also there is a problem of external fragmentation. We know that in the file system, continuously new files are created and the existing files will be deleted. So that may lead to fragmentation, external fragmentation. It means there are no contiguous blocks available to allocate it to files. So that is called as external fragmentation. To solve the external fragmentation, we need to go for compaction. So the problem is basically contiguous allocation may lead to external fragmentation, and there is a need of compaction, and also it is difficult to find space for file in a contiguous manner. Now let us take an example here and discuss about contiguous allocation of this space. So there is a directory. So these are the entries of the directory. So directory entries basically consisting of the files here. So basically directory maintaining the three construction functions, that is file name, starting block, and length. In case of contiguous allocation, only these are sufficient, that is starting block and length. Then we can allocate the blocks to the file in a contiguous manner. So in this particular directory or folder, there are five files. The file names are count, pr, mail, list, and f. Now let us see how these are allocated to the data blocks. If you take count here, the starting block is 0, the length is 2 here. So the block number 0 in the disk, okay, here it is allocated to count, and the length of this file is 2 blocks. The number of blocks required for the file count will be 2 here. So starting from 0, we need to allocate 2 blocks. Okay, so that is what we can observe here. For the count, the starting block is 0, and since the length is 2, one more block we need to allocate. So these blocks are allocated to the file count. The next file is the PR. The starting block is 14 here, and the length is 3. Now let us see for PR. We are allocating blocks from 14. From 14, 3 blocks we need to allocate, including 14, 14, 15, 16. So these 3 blocks are allocated to the file PR in the contiguous manner. Next file is mail. The mail will have the starting block as 19. From 19, we need to allocate 6 blocks. 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24. So these 6 blocks are allocated to the file mail. The next one is list. The starting block is 28, and length of the file is 4 blocks here. So from starting 28, we need to get 4 blocks, 28, 29, 30, 31. So these 4 blocks have been allocated to the file list. The last one is F, the start block is 6 here, and the length is 2. So we start at 6, and the length is 2 here, we allocate 2 blocks, 6 and 7 for here. Okay, if you look at this particular example, for the files, the blocks are allocated in the contiguous manner. Now let us move on to the next one, that is linked allocation. Here each file a linked list of blocks. Here we maintain a linked list of different data blocks for each file. Here file ends at a null pointer. There is no external fragmentation possible here. In case of contiguous allocation, there was a problem of external fragmentation, hence there was need of compaction. But in case of linked allocation, there is no possibility of external fragmentation. Each block contains a pointer to the next block. So no external fragmentation, no compaction is needed here. Free space management system called when a new block is needed. It will improve efficiency by clustering blocks into groups, but increases internal fragmentation. And one of the examples we can quote here, that is the file allocation table. You know that file allocation table is a file system or allocation method used in the Windows operating systems. In this case, beginning of volume as a table, we take beginning of the volume as a table, index by block number. And it is like a linked list, but faster on this because they are making use of a cache here. And the new block allocation will be very simple. Let us look at what is the linked allocation. As I already mentioned, linked allocation it consists of a pointer pointing to the data block in the disk. That is, each file is a linked list of disk data blocks, and blocks will be scattered anywhere in the disk. So that is what's shown here, that is a pointer in the node is pointing to data block the disk. Now let us see how the mapping will be done here. So this is a linked allocation. As I already told, there are links here. So this particular link is pointing to cube data block. It is representing R here. So that is the displacement into block will be R plus 1. So this was the link allocation. So this is the directory. And the file in the directory is G. And the starting block is 5. And the ending block is 25. From 9 to 25 there will be links created. Okay, so let us follow this particular link here. So it is pointing to block number 1, sorry, block number 9 here. So that is the starting block for the file G. From 9 there is a pointer that is pointing to the next block. The next block is 13. From 13 there is a pointer to the next block, that is 16. From 16 to the next block 1, we have got the pointer. So there is a pointer from 1 to the next block 2. From 2 to 18 to 25. So in that minus 1 is stored, that is indicating the end of the block. So that is end block. So like this, in the linked allocation we are maintaining the pointer which is pointing to the next data block in the disk. Now let us look at the file allocation table that is being used in older Windows. So this is a directory entry in the file allocation table. It is having name, that is name of the file, and a start block. So this is an entry in the file allocation table that is called as directory entry. It is having the name followed by start block. The name is test here. The start block is 217. So we have got a pointer from directory entry to the block number 217 here, and at 217 we are storing the value 618, which is basically a reference to the block number 618, and we move to the, so there is a link here from 618 to, that is 217 to 618. At 618 we are storing the block number 339, so that is basically acting as a pointer to the block 339. And finally minus 1 is stored here. So that is how links are established in case of array allocation table. It is similar to link list. Now let us move to the next one, that is the indexed allocation. So here each file has its own block index. Block index are pointers to its data blocks. So let us see what is the logical view of indexed allocation. So there is index table maintained here, and every, that is entry in the index table, is having a pointer that is pointing to the corresponding data blocks. Let us look at example of index allocation. So this is a directory entry here, the file name is zip, and the index block is 19 here. So this index block, that is 19, is maintaining a index table. So index table basically containing pointers to the data blocks which are allocated to the file zip. So the data blocks allocated to the file zip here is 9, 16, 1, 10 and 25. At block number 19, we are maintaining an index table. And from the index table or from the block 19, we have the different links or pointers pointing to the block. For example, a link or a pointer pointing to the block number 9. Similarly, there is a link to block number 16, link to block number 1, and the link to block number 10, and link to block number 25. So this is what the link allocation. Here in the linked allocation, there is a need of maintaining index table. To maintain index table, one data block will be consumed, so that is bit expensive, and it is suitable for random access. Whenever you want to access data randomly, then we can make use of index allocation. Here dynamically we are able to access without any external fragmentation, but there is a overhead for maintaining the index table. So here basically we are maintaining a linked allocation. We have the pointers to Q and R. Q is basically displacement into the index table. R is displacement into the block here. Here mapping from logical to physical in a file of maximum 256 kilobytes and block size of 512 bytes, we need one block for index table. One extra block is needed for index table. Now, mapping from logical to physical in a file of unbounded length, that is a block size of 512 words. Here we can make use of linked scheme, a link blocks of index table. There is no limit on size here. Here it's a link allocation, 512 by 511. We have got references to Q1 and R1. Q1 is basically a block of index table, and R1 is used like this. So R1 is of 512 bytes. It is having Q2, that is a displacement into block of index table. R2, that is a displacement into the block of file. Here a two level index. Here we are making this two level index. Here we can have a fourth K, that is 4000 blocks, and it can store 1024 4 byte pointers in the outer index, and 148567 data blocks will be present here, and file size can be up to 4 GB. It can be represented like this: linked allocation, that is 512 bytes per 512 bytes, and there are two references, Q1 and R1. Q1 is displacement into the outer index. So there are two index tables maintained here, outer index table and inner index table. So there are pointers from outer index table to inner index table, and there are pointers from inner index table to the data blocks in the memory or disk. So that is what Q1 is basically displacement into outer index here, and R1 is used like this. R1 is referenced into Q2 and R2. Q2 is basically displacement into the inner index table, and R2 is displacement into the block of file. So that is what is shown here. So these are the block of file. There are two index table maintained here. This is inner index table, this outer index table. So there are pointers to inner index table, and also there are pointers to the blocks of the file. So this is how we can take index allocation. In case of Unix file system, we'll find the combined scheme. It's a combination of different schemes we can observe here. Here the size of each block is 4 kilobytes, and here we can make use of 32 bit addressing. Here we can observe, in this particular thing we will find the mode, owner, timestamps, and size block count. So these are the fields maintained here. This thing we need to focus more here, that is the directory blocks. So these are the basically data blocks, and this is basically a single indirect block. Here we make use of linked list. So this is double indirect. Here we make use of two index tables are maintained. This is outer index table, these are inner index table. So these are the pointers to the data blocks. So like this, so in Unix file system we will find the combined schemes here. Now let us move to the next topic, that is performance of the allocation method. Which allocation method is the best one? Contiguous allocation is useful for sequential and also for random access. Linked allocation is good for sequential but not for random access, because in the linked list we access the nodes sequentially one after another, but random access is not possible in case of linked list. So linked list allocation is good for sequential but not for random access, but continuous allocation can be used for both sequential as well as random access. Index allocation is more complex, because a single block access requires a few index blocks, and the clustering can help to improve the throughput and to reduce the CPU overhead. Now let us look at the free space management. A file system maintaining a free space list to keep track of available blocks or clusters. Here we can use the term block here. So there is a technique called bit vector. So we need to maintain a bit vector that is also called as a bitmap. It is having the all n blocks of the file. So this is indicated like this. So the n blocks of the file is indicated like this. As a bitmap, it is having the n blocks, for which are indicating n bits here, starting from 0, 1, 2, and the last one is n minus 1. Here, in this particular vector, bit of I is equal to 1 if a block of I is free. If any of the block is free, it is marked as 1. If I block is already occupied, it is already been utilized, then the corresponding bit will be 0 in the bit vector. That is, bit of I is equal to 1 if a block of I is free. Bit of I is equal to 0 if block of I is already occupied. And the block number calculation can be done with this particular formula. The number of bits per word into number of 0 number of zero value words plus offset of first bit. Using this formula, we can calculate a block number. Here we need to protect a pointer to free list. A bitmap must be kept on the disk, that is the overhead. Copy in memory and disk may differ. Cannot allow a block of I to have a situation where bit of I is equal to 1 in memory and bit of I 0 on the disk. And solution to this problem is set bit of I is equal to 1 in disk and allocate a block of I, then set bit of I is equal to 1 in the memory. So that is how this problem can be solved here. And bitmap requires extra space because to maintain the bit vector, extra space is required, that is a bit expensive. So let us calculate how much amount of space is required to maintain the bit vector. If the block size is 4 kilobytes, that is 212 bytes, disk size is equal to 240 bytes, so that is 1 terabyte. If you convert into bytes, it will be 2 raised to 40 bytes here. Then the number of blocks, that is n, is equal to 2 raised to 40 divided by 2 raised to 12, is what that 2 raised to 28 bits or 256 megabytes. If we create clusters of 4 blocks, then the memory required will be 64 megabytes. So to maintain bit vector in the memory, 64 megabytes of memory will be required. So that may be a bit expensive, but it is easy to get contiguous files here. And also here we can go for linked list for maintaining the free list, but here we cannot get continuous space very easily, but there is no wastage of space in case of linked list, and no need to traverse the entire list if the number of free blocks are recorded. Now let us look at link to the free space list on the disk here. So here there is a linked list head that is pointing to first free block. From that we are having a pointer to the next free block, 3, from 3 to 4, 4 to 5, 5 to 8, 9, 10, 11, 11 to 12, 13, 17, and so on. So this is, as you can see here, at the last free block there is a nil store here, that is indicating end of the linked list. So that is how we can maintain a linked list, free space list here. So there is another technique, that is grouping. So in the grouping, what we can do is modify linked list to store address of the next n minus 1 free blocks in the first free block plus pointer to the next block that contains free block pointer. So like this we can group, we can do the grouping. So the next approach is counting, because the space is frequently contiguously used times 3 with the contiguous allocation or clustering. So keep address of first free block and count the following free blocks, free space list then has entries containing addresses and counts. So this is the end of our system implementation. Thank you.